Hey everyone, in this video we're going to be looking at how to do hypothesis tests for proportions. Now I'm going to assume that you've already watched my first video on hypothesis tests that goes through sort of the general process. So this is mostly just going to be about how to do the calculations, and I'm not going to talk much about the meaning and the bigger picture. So if you haven't already seen the first video, please go ahead and watch that one. So for proportions, the test statistic that we're going to be using is given by this formula here. Just like with confidence intervals, proportions use a z-score. So this is going to be using our regular normal distribution. So we've got an example here. We want to test the claim that the majority of adults feel vulnerable to identity theft. And in order to do that, we're going to take a poll. A poll is conducted and it shows that 531 people out of 1,003 surveyed felt vulnerable to identity theft. And we're going to use a 0.05 significance level. So our first step is to take our original claim and write it in symbolic form. Now the claim we're looking at is that the majority of adults feel vulnerable to identity theft. So this is a claim about a proportion, right? This is the proportion of all adults, and majority would mean more than half. So we would say our proportion is greater than 0.5 or greater than 50%. Now the opposite of this claim would be p less than or equal to 0.5. And from these, we can determine our H0, our null hypothesis. Remember, this is always the equals version, right? So this, the null hypothesis would be that exactly half of people feel vulnerable to identity theft. And then our alternative hypothesis is the one of these two that does not have the equal sign. So in this case, that would be the same as our original claim, which was p greater than 0.5. Now, because our alternative hypothesis is p greater than 0.5, we're going to be using a right-tailed test here. So this is going to be significant for the sort of the picture that we're thinking about here, right-tailed because we've got that greater than symbol in our claim. So we'll go ahead and actually compute the test statistic. This is based upon the formula that we looked at the beginning of the video. This is p hat minus p over the square root of pq over n. So the p hat, right, this is our sample proportion. So this would be of the people that we actually talked to, looks like 531 out of 1,003 felt vulnerable. So our p hat is 531 out of 1,003. Then the p-value, even though we don't actually know what p is, this test statistic is based upon the assumption that our null hypothesis is true. So if the null hypothesis is true, our p-value is 0.5, so we're using 0.5 in this computation. And then same thing for the p and q here, right? If p is 0.5, then q is also 0.5, so we have the product of 0.5 times 0.5. N was our total number of people that we spoke to, which was 1,003 in this case, and then we have that square root on the bottom. So in this case, our test statistic comes out to 1.86295. We got some more decimal places here. Once you've got the test statistic, there's two different ways that you can do hypothesis tests. One is the critical value method and one is the p-value method. And I'll go through both and we can kind of talk about the differences. So with the critical value method, I'm thinking about taking our normal distribution, and since this is a right-tailed test, I'm thinking about this sort of right-hand end of the distribution. And with the critical value method, sort of like with our confidence intervals, we're looking for a critical value, a z-score, to divide off the critical region. So this here is the critical region. And the area of the critical region is our alpha value. So in this case, alpha was 0.05. That's our significance level. So this is area 0.05. Which means that we're looking for a z-score that has area to the right being 0.05, the area to the left would then be 0.95. And we can look this up in the z-score table. In this case, if we have area to the left 0.95, that's a z-score of 1.645. And this would be our critical value. Notice that this is a little bit different than what we had with the confidence intervals because this is only a single tail, right? Since this is just a right-tailed test, that 0.5 area is only in the right-hand side. If you have a two-tailed test, you would have critical region on both sides. So for the critical value method, once we find the critical region, then the question is, does our test statistic fall in this region? So in this case, our test statistic was 1.8 about. This is larger than 1.645, so in this case we would say, yes, it does fall in the critical region. If it does fall in the critical region, the way we want to think about that is that the probability of this occurring is small. It's sort of in the tail here. So in this case, we would reject H0, our null hypothesis. Now for the critical value method, we're still thinking about this as sort of this right-hand tail here, this area to the right. But instead of using a critical value, we're just going to use the test statistic. So in this case, our test statistic was 1.86. And then we're going to look up this in the value and see what is this area. So look up z equals 1.86 in our z-score table, and the area to the right is 1 minus 0.9686, so this comes out to 0.0314. So this is the area to the right of the test statistic that we computed from before, right? That's where that 1.86 came from. And then we look at this number and say, is this less than alpha? In this case, this is less than alpha, which was 0.05 in this case. So since it's less than alpha, we would again interpret that to say this is a low probability of H0. So again, we would reject H0. So either method will work. It doesn't really matter which option you use. We will look at doing the p-value method most of the time because this is one that we can do easily with the calculator. But for our standard deviation calculations, the critical value method is actually a little bit easier. So it's kind of good to be able to use both, but you can, for the most part, pick whichever one makes more sense to you. So if we do want to do this on the calculator, we're going to go into our stat menu, just like we have for the other tests. And we're going to use the one proportion z test. So for the confidence intervals, we use the one proportion z interval. So this is same kind of thing, but for hypothesis testing. It's going to ask us first what the null hypothesis is, essentially. So in this case, our p0, this is talking about what was the null hypothesis saying about p. So our null hypothesis said that our p was 0.5. So here we're going to put in 0.5 for p0. And then we have the information about the sample that we had. In this case, our x value was 531, our n was 1003, right? That was how many adults out of the total of 1003 were concerned about identity theft. So we have 531, 1003. And then this last piece is what was the alternative hypothesis? So our alternative hypothesis was that p was greater than 0.5. So in this case, we're going to choose the option that says greater than p0. Our p0 in this case was that 0.5. So we select greater than p0, then move down to calculate. It sort of restates our alternative hypothesis here, right? The proportion is greater than 0.5. It tells us this z value here, right? This is our test statistic that we computed before. And then the p here is the p value. And it's a little bit confusing that the calculator uses a little p here. Really, this is our big P, our capital P value. In this case is 0.0312 approximately. And this should be pretty much the same as what we got before by hand. If I scroll back up, our p-value was 0.03. 314. So it's off a little bit. It's typical that when you use the z-score table, you might get slightly different numbers than if you use the calculator, but either one is fine. So again, the calculator method is sort of a shortcut. You would be using the p-value method of either rejecting or failing to reject the null hypothesis rather than the critical value method, since the p-value is something that it calculates for us. Now keep in mind that at the very end, when we say that we reject H0, we then would want to say, well, what does that mean? So if we're rejecting the null hypothesis, that means that we have evidence that the alternative hypothesis would be the case. So we might say, as our conclusion, there is sufficient evidence to support the claim that the majority of adults feel vulnerable to identity theft. That was our rejecting our null hypothesis in favor of the alternative hypothesis that the proportion was greater than 0.5. So here's a problem for you to try. You're going to test the claim that at least 25% of women buy books online using significance level 0.01. We have some information about a survey here, and you're welcome to use either the p-value method or the critical value method. I would suggest go ahead and try both of them and make sure you get the same answer for both. And that's it for this video. Thanks. See you next time.